Good morning. So glad you're here. If you're here in the room, but we're also glad if you're here joining us online or over at our Westside campus. And man, what an incredible journey that we've been on over the last couple of months. We've been able to explore not only some significant encounters with Christ recorded in the Bible, but also in some of our own church family. They've shared some inspiring encounters that they've had with Christ as well. And one thing that I hope you're beginning to notice is that God is more aware of what's going on in our life than almost any of us actually give him credit for. And that's actually what I want you to be especially attentive to and listening to as we get to share another unimaginable experience and encounter that Mike in our church family experienced.
My name is Mike McCabe. We've been attending ACC for a little over a year now. To be really honest, I grew up in the church, so my dad's a minister, and I've got to, my whole life I've been involved in the church and seeing how God works and building my faith from an early age. And our house, the whole theme in our house is about service. And so, for me, how I felt I was gonna serve, my family, my community, my country. I decided to join the military, and it was right around the time of 9/11. So I figured if I was gonna be in the military, I wanted to be and go into war. I wanted to be with the best of the units I could be with. And so I tried out for the Special Forces and made it, became a Green Beret in the Army. And it was an incredible, absolutely incredible career. I loved it. I loved what I did. I've had many close calls where I was able to see God deliver. So I took a job working as a free fall instructor out in Yuma, Arizona. And it was like my dream job too. I get to skydive for the military, teaching military operations of free fall. You've probably seen stuff like that on the movies where guys are jumping out of planes in the middle of the night at, 18, 20, 25,000 feet. And I got to do that on a daily basis and teach. And so, but on October 8, 2014, I had a very young, inexperienced student. It was his seventh jump, and he was doing his first combat equipment jump. And he wound up, the jump was a very simple one during the day. All he had to do was turn left, do a 360 turn right, go forward through the air, pull the chute at 4,000 feet, and the jump was over. And during that jump, somewhere around 7,000 feet, he wound up going into this really wicked spin. Wound up getting on his back, and because he had all this equipment on, he just kept spinning, and it just put him into this G-force. And that's what we're trying to do, is get him so we could turn him over, pull his chute, and save him. We got to a point where, and everything is going so fast. I mean, you're flying at 130 miles an hour. But we got to a point where it was around 2,500 feet. And I remember the other instructor just starting to break off, because that's kind of our floor where there's a device in our chutes and it automatically deploys. If you're going terminal velocity through 1,500 feet or whatever you set it at, it'll automatically punch out your reserve chute. There's just no way, that we were gonna just watch him hit the ground. We tried, and we got him, turned him over, pulled his chute. Immediately I turned and pulled mine, and of course Murphy Law, hit me, and I had a malfunction in mine at extremely low altitude. And when I threw my main out, I didn't realize it, but my reserve deployed because I went through 1,500 feet at terminal velocity, and the two chutes collided and tangled underneath me. And I remember specifically and verbatim, I remember yelling out, and it's in the wind, nobody can hear me, but I just said, God, please spare my life. I found out later I hit the ground at 119 miles an hour. I was alive, and God spared my life. I was a mess. I shattered my lower body. My pelvis broke in half. I fractured vertebrae. I had a severe brain injury, I had brain bleeds. They life-flighted me to the nearest hospital. And then that began the process of just this long recovery, which was probably the darkest year of my life, but cognitively, I was a mess. I had massive vertigo every day, massive migraines. Couldn't really read. My eyes were always blurry. Cognitively, I was really hurting. And he's like, "You're never going to be the same." It's almost like just stop trying, you know. And I remember later, the head surgeon came in, and initially when I came out of the coma, he came in, and this is where I knew God put him in my life. He walked in and he said to me, he said, "Do you mind if I pray for you?" And I said, "Yes, sir, that'd be great." And I remember him ministering to me right there and praying, and just uplifted me and gave me that little bit of hope. Later, going through the process of trying to walk again and recovery and all the rest of it, I mean, I was just in massive pain. And I remember little things where every day was just an incredible amount of pain. And there were times that I would say, "God, I just need to know you're there." And out of nowhere, somebody would come to minister to me. My wife was an incredible support. I could not have done this entire process without her. Not only did she support and help me and pray for me and be just a rock as a family, but she also took care of our little one at the time. You know, two things that when I share my testimony come up, the reason I do it is, one, you can see God's deliverance. Two, even a non-believer can listen to that story and realize there's a God. I mean, there's no way I should be alive today. You know, for me to see God do this, it changed my life to know that God is real, that God delivers, and it builds your faith. It really built my faith.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. And I just encourage you, that's just a portion of his testimony this year. There's obviously a lot of hard things that he went through. And you can go to our website, click on My ACC, and the link will be there so that you can watch the entire thing. But I'm hoping that as he spoke, if you could get through what he was really explaining, that you listen to the significant spiritual realizations that he had come to. And he said, "I've had so many close calls where I've been able to see God deliver me." He said, I knew God brought that doctor into the room for me. And he would pray and he'd say, "God, I just need to know that you're there." And then out of nowhere, someone would come and minister to me in those moments. Well, folks, today we're going to wrap up our time in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, with encounter number 9. As once again, we get a front row seat to witness how God is more aware of what's going on in our life than almost any of us here actually give him enough credit for. Now, today's encounter is actually a pretty familiar story in Luke chapter 19. It's about a guy, maybe you've heard of him, named Zacchaeus. And it's a classic kid's story. If you grew up in the church and you're old enough when you were a kid, there's a probably good chance that you were taught this story on a flannel graph, if any of you remember a flannel graph, but that you also sang a little song about this little man. And just for nostalgic sake today, I'm going to sing that song for you now. And if you know the song, you get to sing along with me. Are you ready today? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, "Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. For I'm going to your house today." Wow, good job. Give yourself a hand. That was pretty good. Man. Now, we've actually just told the whole story of Zacchaeus, but I think we ought to go back to Luke chapter 19 and actually read it for ourselves. So Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. It says, "Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through." Now, I want to remind you, a few weeks ago, we talked about a blind man, Bartimaeus, who had an encounter with Jesus in Jericho, and it would have been along the same path where he had that encounter. But a man there was there by day by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. And so he ran ahead, climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached that spot, he looked up and he said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. And all the people saw this. They began to mutter, "He's gone to be the guest with a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." To seek and to save the lost. Now, you know, when I was a kid, I used to love to climb trees. But I got to be honest, it's pretty rare for me to do that now. Adults don't usually behave like that, especially not in first century Palestine. Zacchaeus literally must have been desperate here, because he didn't seem to be troubled at all by any loss of dignity. See, in that culture, first of all, respectable men didn't run. Remember, they wore robes, and they certainly didn't climb up into trees. So Zacchaeus could have easily been mocked and ridiculed, but he was determined. He was determined. And so today, again, I'd like to offer to you three encounter observations, a couple of applications, hopefully, that you can take with you today, and then we'll be done. So let's start with the first encounter observation. You know, there was a good reason that Zacchaeus behaved so strangely that day. Now, word must have spread pretty quickly that Jesus had entered Jericho, and curiosity got the best of Zacchaeus. I mean, he really wanted to see Jesus. But he found the road that day lined with a crowd of people, multiple layers deep. I mean, it was elbow to elbow, and everyone pushed and shoved for that chance to see Jesus. Now, maybe you've been in a crowd like that before. You've gone to a parade or a festival or a grand opening or whatever, and you're completely swallowed up by the crowd, and you can't see a thing. But that's even more of a problem when you find yourself, shall we say, vertically challenged, which we learn was a reality for Zacchaeus. And if you're short or if you're little, it's going to require some type of height enhancement. Well, by the time Zacchaeus got to Jesus, this thick crowd had surrounded him, making it impossible for Zacchaeus to get anywhere near Jesus. Because not only was he vertically challenged, but remember, he would have been a social outcast and actually hated by his community. And folks, that's because Zacchaeus was the kingpin of the Jericho tax cartel itself. I mean, before he ever climbed that tree, Mr. Z climbed the corporate ladder. As Jericho's chief tax collector, Zacchaeus stood atop a pyramid scheme known as the Roman tax system. See, the Roman government required an oppressive per capita tax from all of its subjects. And they farmed out the collection of these taxes actually to chief tax collectors. And that system was prone to all kinds of abuse, because it rewarded tax collectors for excessive collections. And because of that, they were able to line their pockets with whatever they were able to squeeze out of their defenseless fellow Jews. And so while Zacchaeus might have been short in stature, he was not short on cash. He was wealthy. And so, you know, if I was doing the casting for Zacchaeus the movie, I would cast, I think, like a Danny DeVito type of character for Zacchaeus. I mean, this short social scoundrel with a big bank account and an Armani suit. Well, you know, Zacchaeus had been scrupulous and ruthless in his despicable business of extorting taxes from his own people. And so you got to know, when he walked down the street, there wasn't anybody that greeted him. He never got invited to anybody's birthday party. And there wasn't anyone who wanted to name their children after him. So I think Zacchaeus actually climbed that tree that day for at least two reasons. First of all, because there was no way that he could have ever seen Jesus because of the crowd. But I think also because likely it would have been dangerous for him to be in that crowd. Because even though he really probably would hardly know anyone, everyone there knew exactly who he was. And you see, in the Jewish Mishnah, which is the oral law, tax collectors were actually considered to be subhuman. And so, for example, it was forbidden to lie unless it was to a tax collector, because that was considered the same as lying to a dog. And see, understanding that concept helps explain the people's reaction. There was no one in that crowd who was going to be nice to Zacchaeus that day, which meant, really, he was completely cut off from Jesus, and so he had to do something. And verse 4 says, so he ran, and then he climbed a sycamore fig tree. Now, that wasn't that great of a feat, because a sycamore fig tree was easy to climb. That's not the strange part. But it would have been unheard of for a powerful man like Zacchaeus to do such a thing. You see, powerful people wouldn't do anything that would draw attention to one of their physical limitations, in his case, his height. And powerful people would never stoop to such an undignified measure just to get a look at this religiously uncredentialed rabbi. It was one of those moments where, if you're watching, you had to be thinking to yourself, wow, you don't see that every day. But you know what? Desperate measures call for what? Or desperate times call for what? Desperate measures. And apparently, Zacchaeus was desperate. Desperate enough to both run and climb into a tree. Because I think even though he possessed great wealth and accomplishment and power, there was something still missing, some void, some emptiness in his life, and he recognized it. A second observation I would want to make today would be this. Zacchaeus clearly wanted to see Jesus, but what he didn't realize was that Jesus was actually looking for him too. I'm guessing it had to kind of startle Zacchaeus to realize that not only had Jesus noticed him up in the tree, but actually knew him by name. As far as we know, the two of them had never met. And so it had to catch Zacchaeus by surprise that when Jesus called out his name, as we see in verse 5, he says, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I need to stay at your house today. And I don't know if you catch it or not, but there was some urgency in Jesus' words. Come down immediately. Come down right away. Why was it so urgent? Well, it's because Jesus was just passing through. And if you think about it, Jesus would never set foot in Jericho again. This divine appointment for Zacchaeus was now or never. Now, have you ever heard the term a divine appointment? This was one. And, you know, basically a divine appointment is when God sets you up for an encounter with someone who's going to be able to assist you on your spiritual journey, much like Mike described that doctor was to him that day. Well, Zac had never met Jesus, and he couldn't probably have been more surprised if the tree had spoken to him. But fortunately, he recognized that it was a divine appointment. And so he came down at once and gladly welcomed Jesus. And there appears to be no hesitation, just pure joy and delight and gratitude. The third observation I want to make would be this. You know, Zacchaeus climbed that tree to see the Lord, but Jesus went out on a limb too that day. Because remember, in those days, in that culture, tax collectors had the most disgusting reputation. I mean, after all, they worked for the enemy, the hated Roman Empire. And so beside being looked down on literally because of his height, Zacchaeus was also looked down upon because he was a tax collector. And not just a tax collector, he was a crook and a notorious sinner. And so there's no way that any good religious teacher like Jesus ought to be hanging out with the likes of him. And so we notice what happens in verse 7. All the people saw this. And they started muttering. You know what happens when people start muttering? That's not good. He's gone to be the guest of a sinner. And what's interesting is there was a similar grumbling just 4 chapters earlier in Luke chapter 15. And it also concerned Jesus' associations with tax collectors and sinners. And that time it actually caused Jesus to tell 3 stories about lost things that had been found. You remember what they were? A lost sheep, a lost coin, a lost son. But you know, here too was someone lost who was about to be found. And Jesus made it clear that's why he was here. Back in Mark chapter 2, he said, when he was accused of this, he said, you know, hey, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, it's sick people. And I've not come to call the righteous, but I've come to call sinners. So what does that mean for us? Well, let's take a look at some encounter applications today and maybe what we can walk away with here today. And the first application would be this. Folks, there's a measure of Zacchaeus in every one of us. And the reason I know that is because I'm pretty sure every single one of us in this room feels like we fall short in some area of our life. Because there are places and spaces where we don't feel like we measure up compared to other people, which is why the story of Zacchaeus should give us so much hope. And it might not be our height, but maybe for us it's our looks, or our talents, or our abilities, or our intelligence, or our education, or our financial resources, or our opportunities. And so I'm imagining that some of you may have some things in common today with Zacchaeus. I mean, maybe like him, you've heard others talk about Jesus, and so maybe you'd like to know a little bit more. And maybe like him, you found out that money doesn't really satisfy. Or maybe like Zacchaeus, you feel kind of lonely and isolated by others. And if that's so, whatever's prompted you to be here to search for Jesus or to come to worship today, I would hope that like Zacchaeus, that you wouldn't be easily deterred, that you'd stay with it. And regardless of where you may feel short in life, imagine most of us here maybe have been experiencing a guilty conscience for how we've actually been living our lives. And that's because the Bible's pretty clear in Romans chapter 3, verse 23. It says, for all fall short of the glory of God. Why? Because we've all sinned. And what that means is that we've said yes to what God says no to, and we've said no to what God has said yes to. And so the common denominator for all of us today is sinner. And that's why the gospel is such good news for us. Because even though we might not know who Jesus is, Jesus knows every one of us by name. And I would hope, we've been encouraging people to read through the Gospels. As you've been reading through the Gospel these last few months, I hope you've noticed how Jesus sees so many people. I mean, no matter where he is or what's happening around him, he just notices people. His eyes were always open, and his heart was and always will be drawn to people, and he calls his own sheep by name. Zacchaeus, hurry, come down. I already mentioned how shocked Zacchaeus must have been that Jesus used his name. It was as if Jesus actually knew him, which of course he had known him since the beginning of time. And that same reality is true for every one of us. And we all need a Savior. And what Zacchaeus' story clearly demonstrates is that there is literally no sinner that is beyond God's grace. If you think about it, Jericho was Jesus' last stop on his way to Jerusalem where he was going to die. And it's where a man named Zacchaeus actually came down from a tree, and someone very lost was found by the very one who was on his way to Jerusalem, where he would be lifted up on a tree, on Calvary's tree, in order to save the lost, whom he's always been seeking. And verse 10 is usually defined as the key verse in the Gospel of Luke, because it expressed by Jesus himself the very purpose of his life and ministry. And it's not very long, and it's pretty simple. If you look in your notes, man, 14 monosyllables, none of which has more than four letters, and yet they reveal Jesus' mission of seeking and saving a lost world. Remember what it said? For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost. Second application we need to take away today is this. There are no unchanged Christ followers. There really can't be. Now, Zacchaeus' life was successful by worldly standards. I mean, he had a pretty important job. He's chief tax collector. And it had indeed made him wealthy and rich. But we can assume that he really couldn't have been truly happy or fulfilled, because his riches were gained
by mistreating people. But all of that changed when he met Jesus. Now, I wish we could see it, but we're not given any indication of what kind of conversation took place between he and Jesus during their time together in his house. But we have to assume it must have been extremely transformational, because whatever they discussed, we do know this. Zacchaeus experienced a genuine heart change. Because, you know, the pledge that he made that day had the potential to completely redistribute all of his wealth to other people. I mean, remember what he said? Half of it I'm going to give to the poor right now, and the other half was likely consumed restoring the fourfold that of those he cheated. But you know, that's what becoming a Christ follower actually looks like. It means you start to treat people the right way. And when you find out that you've not, you do everything you can to make it right, regardless of the cost. And so I want you to think, can you picture the scene just a few days later? There's a knock at someone's door, and they look out the window, and the homeowner exclaims, "Oh no, it's Zacchaeus. He's probably here to squeeze more taxes out of us." But instead, when they open the door, Zacchaeus instead humbly explains, "You know, a couple of years ago, I think I overcharged you $1,000 on your taxes. I am so sorry for cheating you. I follow Jesus now, and so I want to make it up to you. Here's $4,000, and you can count on me to never take advantage of you ever again." You see, knowing Jesus had changed a taker into a giver, and it changed a fraud into a friend. And folks, that's because true repentance brings about real change. It has to. See, repenting is when we decide to turn to God. But you can't turn to God without turning from sin. Now, Zacchaeus' actions clearly demonstrate how his heart had been radically transformed. Because, you know, at one time, he had been all about the money. I mean, regardless of how unscrupulous he had been attaining it. But after he saw and met Jesus, money was no longer his priority. He found a much deeper satisfaction for his life. So I want to ask everybody here today, how does your life look different with Jesus at the center of your life? How does it look different? And does the way you live on a daily basis reveal the difference that Jesus has made in your life? See, one of the ways to identify that you've truly grasped the grace of God is if it motivates you to be willing to let go of everything else, because it's more important than anything else. Now, Zacchaeus was determined to see Jesus, and I just want to mention there's an important message for every seeker that is here today, and maybe you're just here checking this out. If you're truly seeking Jesus, one of the things you probably need to be aware of is that you can kind of expect the crowd, you can expect the world to probably try to make it harder for you. I mean, maybe even make fun of you. Even friends and family may ask, "Hey, what's wrong with you? Why are you so into Jesus right now?" And when faced with that kind of opposition, you know what happens? Many people won't climb the tree. They'll just go home because it's a lot easier that way. But if you're curious about Jesus and you're intellectually open to knowing him, I want to encourage you, be persistent and don't let anybody get in your way or stifle your interest. Because honestly, if you're going to meet Jesus, you're going to have to seek him in some form or fashion. Because folks, it's the attitude that is seeking Jesus that's the attitude that finds salvation. And so once again, I think what Zacchaeus' encounter with Christ demonstrates for us is that God really is more aware of what's going on in our life than almost any of us give him credit for. And so if you're sitting there today and you're kind of wondering to yourself, "Hey, I wonder what Jesus thinks about me. Would he stop for me? Would he want to have dinner with me?" And you know what the answer is? It's yes. And the reason we know that is because in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, here's what Jesus said. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in. We'll have dinner together. We'll get to know each other like we've never known each other before. And maybe some of you sitting there today, maybe that's where you are. Because I think as it was true in Jesus' day, it's also true today. I mean, there are some people that are resisting. Maybe that's where you're sitting today. Some people are trying to ignore. Other people are just oblivious. But some are ready. And if you're ready, today's the day. Let's pray. Father, it's hard for us to even begin to fathom that with 8 billion people on this planet, that you would know each of us by name. But that's because long before this world was ever created, you had us in mind. And Father, today we sense in this interaction with Zacchaeus how much Jesus loves every single one of us. And a lot of us here, we know that. We've accepted it. We live in it. But there could be somebody here today, Father, who needs to open the door for Jesus into their heart. And I pray that you would draw them to yourself today and draw all of us, reminding us of how incredible it is to be in fellowship with you, to be loved by you, to be able to know that there's a purpose for your life beyond just living and dying. God, come today to our rescue. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.